don't know exactly when it was discovered. It was found in 1991 by a member of our St. John the Baptist Cathedral in Washington, D.C., who was found it at Garth. And he brought it back to Washington. We looked at it, those of us who saw it with him, and felt that it would be important to translate it into English. And our deacon there, Father Leonid, translated it. I edited the translation, and we've been waiting for an opportunity to publish it, which has been done this year of the centennial, 100 years later.
What was your most aha moment with this book?
Well, I think it was just the whole diary of Father Afanasy. It was just one aha after another. What he described was just a deeper dimension of this family. And what he, one of them was Kerensky's impression. That was really interesting, quite unexpected. Kerensky actually did return to the church in his later life. And one of his last confession was heard by Bishop Basil Rodzianko when he was still Father Vladimir in London.
Did it make it more personal for you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And reading the diary, I felt that the descriptions of Father Afanasy gave me the sense of actually being there. I felt a little bit like I saw and felt what it was like to be there. Mm-hmm. And I must say, I particularly enjoyed, on a lighter side, his enjoyment of all the menus. I only mentioned one of them. But he described the menu of everything he was served during Lent. Mm-hmm. He obviously enjoyed them. And they're almost a little mini cookbook of what the palace served during Lent, or Lenten meals. It looked quite good. Grace.
Marilyn, where did Kerensky die? While he was at Stanford, or was it
Well, I think in New York, Grace. I think he died.
And what year do you know?
Sometime in the early 60s, I believe.
1971.
Ah, thank you. Very good, thank you. Later than I thought.
Did Kerensky write his memoirs?
He did. They were published in 1965, actually, in New York. Very, very interesting. Mm-hmm. I thought what he described on that. He did a complete turnaround. But his description of his impression, I was just a cog in a wheel.
Yes.
Very interesting.
Unfortunately, he was.
Was he trying to help, actually, at one point? I'd read in another book, The Family Get Beyond Siberia and Escape.
I think he was. His original assignment was to arrange for them to leave Russia. Mm-hmm. Which didn't work for various reasons. Mm-hmm. But I think he thought by sending them to Siberia, to Tobolsk, mm-hmm. he would be removing them from the arena of action in Petrograd. Mm-hmm.
In that photo, is that the Jesus icon that's in the museum up in the corner?
It's not. It wasn't in this room. It was in the room
Looks
of the Grand Duchess's.
Like
there, the bedroom of Grand Duchess Anastasia and Marie, the two younger Grand Duchesses. And there are photographs showing it in the room, and they took it with them to into exile. You see it in, you'll see in the exhibition, you can see the photographs of it. Yes?
Is there any other precedent for killing the whole family, the royal, so to speak?
Shakespeare.
Well, there were many, of course, in Russia. There were probably many families killed.
I mean, like the top family being all killed.
Close to it was the French Revolution, wasn't it? Louis XVI, Marie Antoinette, and the Dauphin was eventually killed.
When King Charles of England was put to death, it was just him. In the 1600s.
Yes.
The end of the Civil War.
Yes, Father Anderson.
I think it's interesting that the Soviet thought that they were demeaning the family by putting them in simple beds and simple circumstances, but they didn't realize that the children were all raised sleeping on cots without pillows.
That's right.
So that was actually, I mean, yes, they had, it did evolve horribly, but at first, that sort of limitation was really just natural for them already. They already were not spoiled and not pampered.
Absolutely. They lived actually a very simple and loving family life.
And they had a Scottish or English nanny,
yes,
who fed them very tough oatmeal in the morning.
Yes, that's quite right.
Was there any mention in the diary of the Tsarina's friend Anna, who
Anna
seems to mention so much?
No, well, only once. Father Afanasy noted when she was at the Alexander Palace in those early days of the house arrest, but she was arrested and taken to the Peter and Paul fortress.
Right.
She actually was in the fortress, and he mentions when that happens.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, Anna Virubaba also wrote a very interesting book of memoirs, Memoirs of the Russian Court. It's a wonderful description.
That's
it's very. Her
so
story
close
is
to
very
the family, wasn't she?
I'm sorry?
Exceptionally close to the family?
Oh, yes.
The family members.
Yes, yes, yes. She traveled with them on their summer holidays on the Standart to Levadia. And she had seven wonderful photo albums,
mm-hmm,
which are at Yale University in the Meineke Rare Book Library. I edited those some years ago, and they were published in the Romanov family album. It was 1981. And the albums, as I discovered later in the 90s, when I was able to see the family albums in Moscow at the State Archive, were exactly the same. The albums were exactly the same albums, and many of the photographs were the same also.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the family left an extraordinary memoir of their life. We can put together their life looking at these photo albums, all of which were saved. They're all in GARF, they're all in the State Archive. Their letters, their diaries, everything was saved. We can see their whole life. It's really quite remarkable. There's a wonderful, really excellent biography of Nicholas II that was written by a Russian writer, Alexander Bohanov, who was originally a communist, member of the Communist Party, very anti-monarchist, and he somehow came across their photo album. Someone, a friend of his, showed him these albums, said, just take a look at these. He looked at these albums and he said, there's no way these people could have done all that's described about them.
Mm.
He was quite taken by the family, and he wrote an excellent biography. Russian. It's still, we have a wonderful translation of it. We just need to have it published. We hope that might be done here, but we'll see.
Marilyn, there's a question from one of our online audience.
Uh-huh.
It's a bit after the house arrest and the period that we're talking about, but the question is, what can you tell us about Princess Helena's attempt in Yekaterinburg to see the Tsar?
Well, she was not able to. I think is she referring to the Serbian princess,
yes,
who left? Yeah, she was able to leave.
Maybe you could explain to the audience who the characters are and who Princess Helena was and what the circumstances are.
Well, she was the wife of one of the sons of Grand Duke Constantine. What was his name?
Yuan,
right. Who was killed with Grand Duchess Elizabeth and the other members of the Romanov family in Alapayevsk. And he wanted her to leave and to save the family, to raise the children, which she did. And she somehow was able to do that. Exactly how that came about in detail, I don't know. But she was able to do that.